If you're able to stand up on your feet, clap your hands, give God some glory. Come on, let's lift this name up.
Bless your name. This place. Hallelujah.
Great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is He. Clothed in glory, arrayed in splendor. Great and mighty is He. Everybody.
Glory, glory. though he's all these things to you, because he is a God that is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'm glad today that I'm able to even come into the house of the Lord, lift up my hands and say, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! See, what I know is that you don't know, like I know, how good God has been to me. Listen, quick testimony. We had an incident over on 1812 North Turner. At our residence where we live, my wife, my mom, for some apparent reason, I don't know why, someone came by and sprayed our house with bullets. I mean, this, it left us stunned. But do you know that God is a deliverer? Listen. My mom was lying in her bed and a bullet went through her mattress. I mean, can you imagine? But God, hallelujah. You know what went through my mind? God is a savior. And then what went through my heart? I got to pray for these people that God would save their souls and bring them into salvation. See, that's what God wants us to do. He don't want us to pick up a gun and go chasing after somebody that's done something unrighteous and wrong to us. But he wants us to stand firm on his word that tells us to love those who misuse you unrighteously. So I thank God, first, that no one was hurt. Hallelujah. And then I thank God that he gave my wife and I and my mom a heart to pray that same night for those people who did the crime. God, thank you. And then even after that, we were on 5 a.m. prayer with my pastor and the other intercessor. And we went in. Oh, we went in. I mean, we had church right there on the phone line, 5 a.m. Thank you, God. I thank God for his saving power. I thank God for his grace and his mercy. I thank God that he is a restorer of our faith. When we've been through something that has brought us down, he restores us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we give God? So we have a great, you don't have to remind me how great, hey, how great our God is. He has proven himself time and time and time and time and time and time and time again. I just thank you. So listen, God is worthy to be praised and to be honored in this place. Just want to welcome you. Did all that just to welcome you. That kind of sets the stage to show you what our God can do, so we can welcome you, to welcome you into his presence. Online and in-house, we welcome you. Welcome you to shout and give God glory. Our God is great and worthy of praise. Thank you, God. We're going to do our responsive reading for today. I love this responsive reading. My, it's just, we put it together. We put God's word is well put together. But when God put it in his people's hand, who are well capable of putting it together, it's wonderful. It's wonderful. So I'm gonna read our December responsive reading and the theme, the breaking through of the King, his kingdom, dominion, and authority. Did you hear that? That's what I'm saying. It's well put together. Thank God. The breaking through of the King, his kingdom, dominion, and authority. Hallelujah. God, thank you for that. Our meditation verse will be John 1:14. We have multiple verses. The first verse is Isaiah 7:14, then Isaiah 9:6, then John 1:14, then Philippians 2:9 from the NLT version. But our meditation verse today will be John 1:14. And let's read Isaiah 7:14. All right then, the Lord himself will give the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Hallelujah. Isaiah 9:6 says, for a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government rests on his shoulder, and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Hallelujah. John 1:14. So the word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father, one and only Son. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Philippians 2:9-11. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all names. Verse 10, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, the glory of the Father. Hallelujah. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Hallelujah. That Jesus, that name above any other name, there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. That name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Our mission statement. Our mission statement for today. Yes, it should be. Oh, maybe it's not over here. But most of us know it by heart. The mission of Union Missionary Baptist Church is to operate as a 21st century New Testament church, empowered by the principles of God's unchanging word, engaging in ministry relevant to a changing world. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's pray. Let's pray. Well, God, we thank you. And God, we know that you, God, has poisoned your people right now to do awesome and wonderful thing, because you are an awesome and wonderful God. So God, we lay ourselves before you as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto you, which is our reasonable, God, thank you, service and worship unto you. So God, as you've already prepared us for worship, God, always say, God, you've tilled the ground to receive the seed, God. There's nothing wrong with the seed, God, but it is your word. But our hearts sometimes can be dark and clouded, God. So till the grounds of our hearts, God, that we might receive the word that will go forth today in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We will forever give you glory, God. Would you do that right now, God? Now, God, you are faithful to do it. So we receive it in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Now bless your word as it goes forth, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, bless our ears, God, that it might not fall on deaf ears, God. God, bless our hearts that we might receive the seed, God. Thank you for salvation today. Somebody needs, God, to hear from you. today. So we thank you, being proactive, God, that you will save some today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we give you praise, honor, and we glorify your name. Let's worship God in this place because he's worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
If you're able to remain standing in worship, we're not going to put any pressure on you, but if you're able to, we just want to declare the name of Jesus and the fact that he is worthy to be praised. Really, the theme this morning is he is mighty.
Yes.
Our God is mighty. He's a mighty God. Thank you, yes. Minister Joe, for that testimony. Another reminder that our God is mighty. He sees all, he knows all, and he is in control. Bless the name of Jesus. I want to challenge you, even if you're going through, just to begin to declare that the Lord is mighty. Even if it seems hard to do that today because there's something weighing heavy. Maybe you've lost a loved one. Maybe there's a job situation. Maybe one of your children or grandchildren is out in the world. Whatever it might be that's been heavy on you this season, just begin to declare, Lord, you are mighty. 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 Our God is mighty and worthy to be praised. I'm going to ask that you join us in making the declaration that our God is a mighty God and there is none like him. And I know many of you know this song, so don't just listen, participate and be free in here. Walk around, get in a place where you can extend your hands and give God praise. It's all right, we want you to be at home in worship as long as it's to the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Lord, you're mighty.
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 Lord,
you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Oh,
Lord, you're mighty.
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 Lord, you're mighty. Do that again.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty. Come on, y'all say that with me.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, tell it, tell it.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Oh,
Lord, you're mighty.
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 Oh, Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Hey. You set your glory above the heavens and the earth. When I think of all you are.
Power in the name of Jesus. just want to thank God. That's with grateful hearts, we bless our Father. For joining us in worship. Please stay in a spirit of worship. For those that are joining us online, thank you. Welcome. Welcome to all of our guests. Welcome. We are grateful to God for all of you. We thank God for your presence here today. It's a sweet spirit in this place today. It really is. It really is. This is what worship should feel like. Sometimes you just can't let go, but just stay in worship. That's where we are today. And we're grateful and thankful. Let's go. Let's jump into the word. Let's jump into the word. You know that's still worship, right? It's actually the highest point of worship. And that's when the Lord speaks to us through his word. So I just want to say a word of prayer and I want to jump into the word. So join me in praying. Father, we love you. Song just says it all. There's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. There's no sweeter name have I ever known. There's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. You are the light to my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to the hopeless and broken. You are the only truth and the way. So Lord, we thank you for being the way. Father, we love you. Father, we worship and adore you. Now we're at the high point of worship, and that's when you speak to us. You have been speaking, but Lord, now we need a rhema word, a specific word from you. So Father, would you focus all of our hearts and minds on your word? And Lord, would you have your way? Holy Spirit, we give you free rule and reign in this place. We welcome you. Lord, we promise after all that is said and done, we'll give you glory because you deserve it. We love you, Father, and thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'm almost ready to just open the doors, but I mean, that was just good. Some Sundays, it's just worship. Some Sundays, it may just read a passage of scripture and call it a day. But I done lost focus. I'm looking at my notes and I can't even focus on my notes. So Lord help. I'm going to try it. Let me see how it goes. I don't have a passage of scripture that I'm going to read from. Actually, I can just read one verse. That's Acts 16. I don't even know what verse it is. It's verse 9. It says, during the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, come over to Macedonia and help us. Come over to Macedonia and help us. Well, I started a series earlier this month. Well, it was actually in November, November the 7th, the first Sunday in November, with the title, Come Over to Macedonia and Help Us. I talked about that the whole month, and we walked through the cities that Paul and his company visited in Macedonia, which is what we know today as Greece. It's in Europe. And so we see that Paul and his companions were standing in Asia Minor on the coast, and Paul had a vision of a man across the sea in Europe, Greece, beckoning him to come over to Macedonia and help. Paul and his companions jumped on a boat immediately and went over across the sea to Greece, to the region of Macedonia. In that region, Luke, who wrote the book of Acts, who was with Paul, he recorded three places that they stopped at in Acts 16 and 17. So for the month of November, we were looking at each city that Paul and his companions stopped in. They stopped in Philippi, which was the first city. Then they stopped in Thessalonica, which is the second city, and the third city was Berea. And from those three cities, the Lord has given us requirements for ministry on Macedonia based off of the work that Paul and his companions did in the Bible. As I was looking over it when we finished Berea, the Lord gave them or pulled out 10 requirements from those three cities. And I'm just going to just read through those 10 requirements. I'm not going to preach them again. I'm just going to tell you what those 10 requirements are. And the first one from Philippi was there must be a strong male representation. He was just saying there were no men, not enough godly men in the city of Philippi to start a synagogue. And the Lord was showing us that there needs to be a strong male representation when ministry on Macedonia is to begin. Not discounting the women, because the women were working in these cities. There was just no male representation. And so the Lord was challenging us that the males need to step up to the plate, to assume their roles of responsibility. So we see that. Then your house must be a declaration of your faith. We saw in Philippi, talked about Lydia and how she was a pagan and she received Jesus, but she went back home and had everybody in her house baptized. Those that stayed in her house, they were baptized because she made her house a declaration of her faith. If you're going to stay in my house, you're going to know the Lord. You're going to at least live for him in my presence. And so the Lord is telling us that we have to make a declaration of our faith in our homes. Anybody that comes in our homes will realize and recognize not only who we are, but whose we are. And so our faith should ring first out at our homes. And then when we leave, people should still see who we are. And then we must be aware of Satan's tactics. We talked about that as they moved into Philippi and as they were ministering, and this lady, young girl with a demonic spirit, began following Paul and his companions, yelling out, "We know who you are. We know that you're coming to bring salvation to the people. We know what Jesus is doing." And she followed them for several days. And the Bible said that she had a diviner's spirit, which means it was a spirit of Python. We call it Python. The Greek word is Puthon. But we get our English word Python from this particular passage of scripture, because what the devil was trying to do was to squeeze the life out of Paul and his companions by continuously following them, to frustrate them, to anger them, to distract them from the work that God is calling us to do. So we have to be aware of Satan's tactics, because he will try to squeeze the life out of God's people while we are doing work on Macedonia. And so we looked at that. We talked about that. Then he says we must be determined to pray. So even in the midst of the devil trying to squeeze the life out of us, we must be determined to praise. Paul and Silas were locked in prison because they did not allow that possessed little girl to distract them or to destroy them, but instead rebuked the spirit that was in that little girl. And as a result, the girl's owners lost money off of her. So Paul and Silas were beaten severely and thrown in prison. But even in the bottom of a prison, in the cave parts of a prison where no life was there, nobody else was there, Paul and Silas, they could have sat there and soaked and died and killed over, but instead they began to praise. They had a determination to praise God, even in the midst of hurt and pain and discouragement. So can I tell you, the ministry on Macedonia is going to bring some opposition, but we have to be determined to praise. Then I talked about when they moved into Thessalonica, another city. Ministry on Macedonia sees the richness and possibilities within a community. Thessalonica was rich with possibilities. Not a lot of people knew the Lord, but there was a God presence in that city because there was a synagogue. So even Paul and his companions, when they got to that city, they began to see the richness and the possibilities of that community. Then we talked about ministry on Macedonia is rooted and grounded in the Word of God. Everything that Paul and his companions talked about was out of the Word of God. And then ministry on Macedonia will draw opposition. You saw that in Philippi. They drew some opposition, but they were determined to praise. But ministry on Macedonia in Thessalonica also draws some opposition. Then they moved to Berea, and we saw that ministry on Macedonia is consistent in the mission that God has given. It's consistent. The way that they went about ministry in every city, every place that they went, there was consistency. They looked for a God presence. They looked for people who loved the word, who prayed. They looked for all of that. Their approach to the people was all in the word and what the word was about and what the Lord was telling them to speak to the people. It was consistent with the mission that God has given them. And then they were always ready to share the kingdom of God to those who were willing to receive it. They weren't just looking for people who didn't know God. They were looking for those who were in the church, in the synagogues, and ready to receive and to hear about Jesus. That was the Bereans. And then the last one was ministry on Macedonia presses on despite persecution. So now we see three instances in those three cities that wherever they went, they encountered opposition. In all three cities, they encountered opposition, but we thank God that they pressed on in the midst of strong opposition. So they were showing us something as they moved through this region. And I talked about Macedonia is not a place, but Macedonia was a region. It wasn't a city, it was a region. And in that region were several different cities. Luke just identified three that stood out from Paul and his companions as they did ministry in Macedonia. And so we looked at that and we saw that ministry on Macedonia taught us 10 requirements, and all they are from different cities in the Macedonia region. They all show us what we should be doing while on mission where the Lord sends us, all 10 of them. And so what I wanted to do today is I wanted to look at those 10. I began looking at those 10 requirements that the Lord gave us, and I began to see a pattern. I began to see a couple of principles that came out of those 10 requirements from those three cities that they visited and shared the gospel. And so I pulled out two principles that the Lord is showing us from Paul and his companions in ministry on Macedonia. So looking at those 10 requirements that I just ran through, there's two principles that stood out. Two principles stood out. And so here's the first one. Ministry on Macedonia is a mindset. It's a mindset. It's a mindset. Look, we see it. We see it in all those three places. In those three places that it was a mindset. A mindset is an established set of attitudes and beliefs. That's what a mindset is. So when they went into these cities, they had a mindset, a set of attitudes and beliefs in this city. And so a lot of times when we move around into a place, our mindset is not where it needs to be. So there's no focus on the purpose of why we are there. And so we have to understand that the mindset needs to shift as we begin ministry on Macedonia. Can I tell you that? I just want to tell you this. Look, when you see the big picture of what God is planning to do in your life, you will have a mindset change. You really would. And so, you know, it's hard for people of God, it's hard for churches these days to have a full mindset of the whole church to buy into what the Lord is trying to do. Because there's not a shift in the mindset, because not everybody can see the big picture that God is calling. Not everybody really understands that God wants to use you to be a part of his big picture. Not everybody understands that you bring something valuable to the ministry that the Lord has called you to. And once you realize the big picture, then there will be a mindset shift. It's like repentance. It's like repentance. Repentance generally means this. It's a change in the way that you think. And so when I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, what I begin to do is I have to change the way I think. And when I change the way I think, guess what it does? It changes the direction that I'm going. It's a mindset shift. And that's what happens in ministry. Look, can I tell you, God has called Union to a great ministry. God has called all of his churches to a great ministry. But can I just focus on Union right here today? We have a wonderful opportunity to do ministry on Macedonia in this region that the Lord has called us to. But can I tell you, we are struggling right now because not everybody is with us that the Lord has placed here. And the Lord was saying it's because there's no shift in the mindset. There's no shift. There's no shift. They don't realize how valuable they are and how much of the a part of the vision they are. They don't see the big picture. So yet, they are not connected. I'm going to say this, and I'm going to move on. I can tell. I feel Pastor Jackson. I feel his pain. I now know the struggle and the discouragement and the frustration that he faced, because he worked so hard to get us to understand that the Lord had plans for us. But still, not everybody caught the vision. It took me a long time. I had to go back. Lord, where was I at? But when I caught it, I had a mindset shift. I did. And so, yesterday, we had a wonderful workshop on pastoral care. It was excellent. It was excellent on pastoral care by Deacon Goler. I invited the church. Was it full, Deke? No, I wasn't. It wasn't even close. Now, I know some people had legitimate reasons as to why they couldn't be here. But I know some people just didn't go. Now, we streamed it live stream on YouTube. We didn't put it on Facebook. We put it on YouTube. I don't know if anybody caught it on that. We recorded it, so guess what? You can catch it, but you got to go to our YouTube page. But that's an example of a shift in the mindset. We don't do a lot of stuff inside the church. The stuff that we do inside the church is going to prepare us for ministry outside the church. And we need people who have a mindset shift to join us when we have those opportunities, so that we can be equipped to go outside and to be informed, so that when we go outside, we'll know how to follow the Lord in ministry. It's a mindset shift. What does the word say about a mindset shift? Well, Philippians 2:5 says it like this: let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. That's Paul talking to the church at Philippi. Philippi is in Greece. It's in Macedonia. So now Paul is writing back to this church, telling them you need a mindset, and the mind that you need to have is the mind that Jesus had. So let this mind that's in your, let this mind, Jesus's mind, be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. So we have to understand that God is talking through Paul, telling all of us that we have to have a mindset shift. Colossians 3:2, Paul's talking to the church at Colossae, another church that Paul established, and now he's writing to this church saying, set your minds on things above, not on things on the earth. Look, he said, look, don't start thinking about all the things that you can get, that you want, all the material stuff. But he says, when you have a mindset shift, that everything that you do is built and rooted and grounded in God, you don't have to worry about the stuff that happens down here. Set your minds on things above and not on things down here. That's why a lot of churches don't have participation, because a lot of people are still earthly. They haven't shifted their minds. He says it like this in Romans 12. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, that you, by testing you, he may discern what the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect, will is. Look, he says, don't be shaped by this world. Because when you start to be shaped by this world, you can't have a mindset change. Well, it will change, but it will be shaped by the world. So he's saying don't be conformed, but transform your minds. Then Philippians 4:8, Paul says it like this, right back to the church at Philippi. He says, finally, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if anything that's worthy of praise, think about these things. Look, when you start thinking about stuff that's lovely and admirable and pure and holy and righteous and excellent, when you start thinking about the Lord in that area, can I tell you what's going to happen? You're going to have a mindset shift. And that's what we're looking for. Because here's what happened. Religion tells us this. Stay safe and comfortable in the church and just wait for heaven. That's what religion says. When we get in the church, you get saved, you get baptized, you do your new member orientation class, you get that over with, and now you just sit in church, be comfortable, and wait for heaven to come. That's what religion teaches. And you know what? Religion is wrong. Religion is wrong. We're operating by the wrong manual when we operate under religion, because religion just tells us, don't do nothing. Come to church on Sunday. Tune in on Wednesday. If you don't feel like it, don't worry about it, but just wait for heaven. Jesus is coming back for you. That's the wrong way to live. That's not how Jesus taught. But kingdom says this, go to the uncomfortable places, go into darkness, go into all the world's systems and invade them with the light of the kingdom. Don't wait for heaven, bring heaven to earth. So, but it takes a mindset shift. Because if you don't have that mindset where you're gonna bring heaven to earth, then you got the wrong mindset. When you have that mindset that I'm going to go into these places that's uncomfortable to me, where I know people don't want to hear or see me, look, when I'm in those places and it's uncomfortable, that's ministry right there. It's a mindset. It's a shift in the mindsets. And so the Bible is telling us that we got to change the way that we think. That's what Ministry on Macedonia is telling us. Here's a second one. Ministry on Macedonia, here it is not afraid to penetrate darkness with the light of the kingdom. It's not afraid. I'm not scared. I'm not scared of nobody but God. I don't care what you got or who you got. I may not win, but I ain't scared of you. You don't scare me. So ministry is not afraid to penetrate those dark places with the light of the kingdom. And then here it is. When you realize that God has you on assignment, there is no reason to fear because he always prevails. When you realize that this is where I'm supposed to be, when you realize that God placed me in this situation for such a time as this, look, I don't have to worry about being scared about who's in that vicinity, because the whatever happens, the Lord is going to cause me to triumph. And so I just got to be ready. I got to be ready to go into those mindsets. What does the Bible say about it? Well, listen to what God told Jeremiah in verse chapter 1. He says, don't be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set you over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. Can I tell you what the Lord is telling? When the Lord has placed you in a place, when the Lord has guided you to a place, when you know without a doubt that you are where you are because the Lord placed you there, look, you are supposed to be kingdom light in that place. Your job is to recognize that I'm supposed to build and to plant. I'm supposed to tear down the evilness. I'm supposed to go in there with boldness and speak what the Lord says, because the Lord has touched my mouth and has given me the words to speak. He has already given me influence to impact those places and the spaces where I am. So all I got to do is operate in the authority that the Lord has given me by the power of the Holy Spirit. 2 Timothy, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. God has empowered us. God has equipped us to extend the kingdom into the earth today. We've been empowered. I'm just talking about what ministry on Macedonia. Those 10 requirements have shown us two principles. Out of those 10 requirements, we see that it's a mindset. We see that it's not, we're not afraid, not to be afraid to penetrate the darkness with the light of the kingdom. So here it is. It's and let me go. It's this breaking through into the darkness that was modeled for us by Jesus Christ. Did y'all hear our responsive reading? It's breaking through of the king, his kingdom, dominion, and authority. But it's this breaking through into the darkness that was modeled by Jesus, our king. So as we celebrate this Christmas season, keep this in mind. We're not merely celebrating a baby that was born in a stable, placed in a manger, celebrated by shepherds and wise men. We're literally celebrating the breaking through of the king, the breaking through of the light, literally the penetrating of light into the darkness. Jesus left the comfort of the kingdom of heaven, his royal throne, the kingdom of light, in order to break through into the darkness of the world's systems, in order to bring the kingdom back to the earth. Jesus came to invade the world's systems with the kingdom of God. And guess what? He's given us the same authority that he had when he came into the earth. He said, now, here's the problem. But here's the problem with world systems that I understand about world systems. World systems cause people to think and to believe things that are not godly. That's what world systems cause people to do things opposite of what the word of God says. It causes us to think God. Look, they cause the rifts between people, places, and organizations. That's where slavery started. Slavery was a result of a system designed to enslave people based off of a created perception that they were not worthy to be looked at as people, but instead property. Look, politics is another system that instead of working together for the betterment of the people, there is division and accusations against each other to the point to where it seems there can be no return or no cohesiveness amongst those parties. Another one, segregation, or what we call Jim Crow, is a system that was created to separate people based off of their color and culture. It's a perception created by a system that we can't live together in a community because of our differences. That is where the redlining came into place. That's where the phrase separate but equal came into place. That is where we see this housing disparities, the economic disparities, the educational disparities, the social disparities. That's how they were formed, because of a created system. But when Jesus came, he broke through with the kingdom of God that is able to destroy a system. He broke through and broke out in us, giving us power and authority to invade those systems with the kingdom of God. So he broke through and he chastised those who were misusing and profiting off of others through the system. He broke through and spoke to those who were hurting and healing and had needed help and hope to the oppressed by the system. He pointed everyone to a kingdom that cannot be shaken by the systems of this world. John 8:12, Jesus says, when he spoke again to the people, he says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So we, as Christ's ambassadors, as kingdom citizens, as imitators of Christ, as representatives of the King, we too are called to penetrate the darkness of the systems of this world with the light of the kingdom of God. Matthew 5:14 says, you are the light of the world. A town that's built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on the stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify the Father in heaven. John 1:4, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness could not overcome it. Look, God has given us power and authority to invade those systems. This is the light that we have in us. It's the light of Jesus. It can never be extinguished or overcome by the darkness. And so we should never be afraid of the darkness of this world. I'm not afraid of the systems or who's in the systems of this world, because I know that I serve a God who is greater than any system that has ever been created. I serve a God who speaks to the system and the systems will flee. I serve a God who can talk to the systems and they will tremble at his name. I serve a God who is greater. The word says, greater is he who is in me than he that is in the world. I understand now about the system. So we should never be afraid to go into those dark places that God sends us, because we are reborn. We are regenerated. We are recreated. We have been repositioned in the kingdom of God. So with authority and dominion, power and influence, we are to go into those places with the light of the kingdom. We've been called to invade our communities. We have been called to invade our government system. We have been called to invade our educational systems. We have been called to invade corporate America with the light of the gospel. I want to understand how God has given me some authority to invade, but it's the spirit that's operating in me that gives me the power to invade those systems. Couple of scriptures. Look, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid if God puts you on assignment to be where you are now. Instead of being afraid, be bold to speak up, to be so close to him that he can touch your mouth and give you the right words to say. Don't worry about not being able to speak, but just get close to him and he'll speak through you. And so what we got to understand is that the people in the systems can't harm you. They're going to try. They're going to try to harm you. Look, I'm talking about the spirit that's in me. I'm happy with where I am. I'm happy with where I'm going. I know where I'm going. And if I lose my life fighting in this system, fighting against this system, guess what? I just lose my life. But I'm not losing my life. I'm gaining heaven. That's what's going to happen. Because when people get scared about the movement of God, the devil's going to get in them and make them try to do the worst things to you, ultimately to try to take you out if it's bad enough. But can I just want, to encourage you, don't be afraid about these world systems. Nobody can do nothing to me that my God can't handle. That's it. Luke chapter 10, let me tell you this. Jesus sent out the 72. He sent them out, told them to go minister. I'm giving you authority to go minister. They came back. They said unto him, Lord, even the demons are subject to us. The demons are subject to us in your name. They're subject to us in your name. We went out. You weren't with us, but the demons were subject to us in your name. Jesus looked at him and he said this, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I saw him fall like lightning from it. Why would Jesus say that? Well, he said it because this. Even in heaven, Satan tried to establish a system in heaven. But my daddy was stronger than he was because he was a created being. My daddy realized it and threw him out of heaven. Satan was under him. He was under us. And so I saw him falling out of heaven. And then he says this, behold, I've given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. He was just really saying, because my daddy is over the prince of the air and the prince of this earth, because my daddy is over, he threw him out of heaven. I have given you that same authority to trample over serpents and scorpions, and nothing is going to hurt you wherever you go. So don't be afraid of what happens to you, because nevertheless, he says, rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you. But no, he says, do not rejoice in the fact that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. I like that. I really do. Jesus was telling, hey, they came back. Woo, we were preaching in your name. They were running. They were running away from us. Those demons were. And Jesus said, look, I saw him. My daddy threw him out. He threw him out. Because of my daddy, now you guys have authority to trample over the sword. He's really saying this. Do the work of the kingdom. Don't worry about the enemy because you already have authority to trample over him. But then he says, don't rejoice in the fact that they're running from you. Don't rejoice that they're subject to you, that they are submitting to the authority that's within you. Don't rejoice in that, but just rejoice that your names are written in heaven, that you are a part of my family now. Rejoice in that, and the demons will submit to you still. And so he's saying, rejoice. Then I'm looking at Ephesians 6:11. He says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers over the presence of darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. So he just says, you got to get equipped. When you go out in Macedonia, don't go out there naked in the spirit realm. Put on some armor. Put on the full armor, so that you can stand when the devil comes. And then last one, Hebrews 12, verse 28 and 29 says, therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. Look, guess what? We've inherited a kingdom that cannot be shaken. That's what the author just said. Look, now that you are part of the kingdom of God, you are a part of a kingdom that cannot be shaken. So when we do ministry on Macedonia and we step out into the community, we have inherited a kingdom that cannot be shaken. It didn't say that we couldn't be shaken in that kingdom, but it says a kingdom that cannot be shaken. But when I am close and holding on tight in the kingdom, I am not shaken because I am anchored in the Lord. That's the song. I'm anchored in the Lord. And so we got to understand. We have to understand that ministry from those 10 requirements, ministry is a mindset. We got to have the mindset of the kingdom. We do. If we're going to do any earthly good for the kingdom of God, our mindset has to change. Do self-inventory as to where you are right now, not where you were 10 years ago or 20 years ago when you got saved. No, where are you right now? Kingdom mindset links up and is looking for opportunities to extend the kingdom. It does. Do an inventory as to where you are. And then do this. If you're not where the Lord has called you to be, first, repent. Apologize. Yeah. And ask him to fill you again. That's what I encourage you all to do. Repent, apologize, and fill me. Fill me again. That's what I'm asking you all to do. And then ministry on Macedonia is not afraid to penetrate the darkness with the light of the kingdom. Look, he's armed us. He's already armed us to go into those places and those spaces. Look, we have no reason to fear. No reason to fear. Because even the demons know who Jesus is. And they tremble and flee. And we have him in us, on us, through us. And all we got to do is just go out and allow him to work in us and through us. It's kingdom living. And so that's where we are today. I just hope you guys were encouraged by that word. I hope. And here's what I hope the encouragement will do. I hope the encouragement will challenge you to shift the way you're thinking right now. We'll be a much better ministry when people's mindset shifts for the kingdom of God. I don't know who it is or I don't know everybody. I can't read minds. I'm not God. But I can see the actions and the pattern of a stagnant person living for God. I can see that just by the pattern. Yeah. Are you bearing any fruit for the kingdom? And so if that's you, then you need a shift in your mindset. And here is it. I don't care what church you go to. If you feel like you need to shift the way you're thinking for the kingdom, then I'm speaking to you. Actually, the Lord's talking to you. And if that's you, then come on down. Just come on down. We'll pray. If that's you, if you're saved already, and you just need a mindset shift, and the Lord is already in your Kool-Aid. If that's you, just walk on down. Just walk on down and stand in the front. Look, don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. Look, it's just an acknowledgement that I need to be wherever you are. That's it. I just want to be wherever you are. Wherever you're working, I want to work. Lord, whatever you tell me to do, I'm going to do it. However it has to come to pass, we're going to do it. And look, by us coming down and making that decision and linking together, we're saying we're going to do it together. No man is an island. We're going to do this together. It's all about kingdom living. It's a shift in our mindset. Wherever the Lord sends me, I'm going to be light. I'm going to be light when I go to work. I'm going to be light in my workplace. When I go to the gym, I'm going to be light in the gym when I go to school. I'm going to be light when I go to school. When the children, when the youth walk the halls of Muncie Central and Muncie Northside and Muncie Southside and Longfellow and Southview and Northview and EWA and Westview and all those other elementaries that we have, when they walk the hallways of we need you all to be light. Don't be deterred by the darkness that's around you, because you have light on the inside of you that has given you authority to trample over scorpions and serpents when you walk in those places. That's where we are. That's what the Lord is just saying. I need light. I need people who are willing to be light in this season that we're here, that we're in. I just need some light. I need some light bearers. Who's going to carry the torch for me in those dark places? There's people walking in darkness. There's people bumping against the wall. There are people that don't have any direction. There's people who's frustrated and ready to throw in the towel. Is there anybody that can be a light, that can speak life and speak encouragement into these people? That's ministry at the highest. And we need people who will penetrate those dark places with the kingdom of God. That's what we need. So we thank God. I thank God for all of y'all. Look, y'all don't know how mad the devil is right now. If y'all only knew how mad the devil is right now. But can I tell you what he's doing right now? He's looking at you. He's looking at you, and he said, I already know. I know how I'm going to get her. I know how I'm going to get you. As soon as you leave, I'm getting you too. When you go to school, I'm getting you. I'm getting you. I'm going to get you tomorrow. You too. When y'all go to Northside and Loaf, I'm going to get y'all. I already know what buttons to push for you. I know you. That's what he's saying already. But can I tell you, what y'all need to say is, greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. Don't be afraid of their faces. Don't be afraid of their faces, because the Lord has given you dominion and victory already over the enemies. So be encouraged. Thank God. I'm excited about what the Lord is going to do through all of you. I'm excited. I'm encouraged about what the Lord is about to do. Let me just stop. I want to just pray for y'all. I want to pray over y'all. I want to pray a cover of blessing. Everybody out there, just stretch forth your hands and just join us in praying over these who have made decisions. So, Father, we bless you. We invade the kingdom of darkness with the kingdom of light with our decisions. Father, we are tired of not being the light bearers that you have created us to be. And Lord, we decree and declare today that from this day forward, we're going to operate as light in your kingdom. People will see us and see you in us, Father, and they will give your name glory. Father, we pray right now that you would strengthen and encourage them and give them courage, God, to invade those dark places, God, where the kingdom needs to be, God, whatever it is, the workplace, the gym, the school, God, the government systems, wherever they work or reside. Father, would you empower them, embolden them, encourage them right now in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, have your way in them. You said that you had given us authority to trample over serpents and scorpions. God, you said that we've inherited a kingdom that cannot be shaken. So, Father, we stand on your kingdom, and we stand on the enemy, and we declare victory and salvation, hope. God, to people who are harassed and helpless, God, we invade those dark places with your light. And we speak life. We speak health. We speak wellness and wealth in their lives in the name of Jesus. So, Father, would you place an angel of protection around them now? Because the enemy is already conspiring against them. He already pulled their file. He's going to their weaknesses now. He's assigning his demons to their weaknesses. But Father, would you cover them? Would you strengthen them? Would you remind them that greater is he that is in them than he that is in the world? Would you remind them that they are more than conquerors through him who loved you? Would you remind them, God, that you will make everything work together for their good? So, Father, I pray for a holy protection over them even now. Bless them as only you can do. We love you, Father, and we thank you so much for loving us. It is in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus that we pray and we ask it all. Amen. Let's give God some praise. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Let's just give him some glory for the work that he's about to do in our lives. For the ministry that's about to happen in our communities. For the mindset shifts that have just occurred in this place. Amen. Thank y'all. You guys can return to your seats. Give God glory. Thank you, Father. We bless you. We honor you. We adore you, Father. We give your name all glory, honor, and praise. There's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. There's no sweeter name have I ever known. God, your name is sweet to your people who say it. And it's a terror to the enemy at the same time. So it's sweet when we're in the midst of opposition and we call on Jesus. But at the same time, it speaks terror to the enemy when it comes out of our mouth. So Father, we thank you for your name. We bless you, Jesus. We give you glory. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Amen. When we thank God for his word, we thank him for his word. Isaiah 55:11 says, once my word goes out, it will not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that which it was sent out to do. And I thank God for what he's doing and what he's going to do in your lives. It's exciting to see it unfold. So we just thank God for all of you. Well, we have one thing to do, one other thing to do. This is our first Sunday, so we're gonna do our communion. That's acknowledging and remembering the great sacrifice of our Lord and Savior. It's remembering that sacrifice. And so there were some communion elements that you could have picked up before you came in. If you did not get any, just raise your hand and we'll make sure we get you some. If you didn't get any, just raise your hand and we'll make sure you get some. But we have a special treat as we go into communion today. One of our oldest members, faithful members, I wanted to give an opportunity to lead us in worship as we go into communion. And that is Deacon Ananias Thompson. Y'all don't know Deke back in his heyday, but Deke could tear a place up with his singing and praying. And so I want us to get a taste. For those young people that don't know Deke, I want you to get a taste of what we used to have with Deke. Now, he's been having some health challenges. He may not sound as strong as he used to, but I want you to understand and see him for who he is. And he's a strong man of God. So, Deke, I'm gonna turn it over to you, sir. Come however you want.
This little light of mine, oh Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light.
Singing right there. That's some old school. I meant to tell Josh, you got to follow him because he'll work his way up and then he got to go back to his seat. So you can't cut it off yet. But that's Deacon Thompson. And we thank God for him. It's always good to celebrate those who have paved the way and made it possible for us to have what we are experiencing today. And we had Deacon Thompson's who was leading us in worship. And we certainly thank God for him. He's not done yet. I got one more song after communion. It'll be after we commune. When we get ready to go, I'm going to have Deacon give us another selection. And so on our way out, we're going to give him a chance to sing another selection. So we thank God for that. It's so fitting. Didn't you hear what song it was? This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, the light. Is breaking forth. The light of the kingdom breaks forth into the darkness of this world, and Jesus tells us to let our light shine. And then Deacon comes along and encourages us in song. So let's focus our hearts right now. Almost 2,000 years ago, Jesus was assembled in the upper room with his disciples. They just finished celebrating what we call the Passover. As they remembered Israel's deliverance from Egypt, where God told them, take the blood of the lamb, sprinkle it over your doorposts. And when the death angel comes through the streets of Egypt, if he sees the blood over the doorposts, he's going to pass over. But the house that does not have the blood on the doorposts, the death angel went in and killed the firstborn child in that house. And so that night, Israel was delivered from Egypt because of that event. And after they celebrated the Passover in the upper room with Jesus and his disciples, Jesus instituted what we now call the Lord's Supper, communion. Jesus told his disciples, this is my bread. He held up some bread. This is my bread that was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And he lifted the cup and said, this cup is the new covenant, my blood. Do this also in remembrance of me. The Bible says he broke the bread, he blessed it, and he told them to eat and to drink all of it. Just want to bless it, because as we remember the horrible sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf, we are forever grateful to him. He reconciled us back to the Father so that we can have fellowship and communion with our daddy. He died a horrible death just for you. And so we celebrate him today. So I say it in my prayer that since Jesus died for me, I'm going to live for him. So join me in prayer. Well, Father, we thank you as we remember. We remember Jesus. We remember his struggle. We remember his beating. We remember the angry crowds. We remember the taunting. We remember the backlash, the backbiting. We remember him being nailed onto a wooden tree. We remember him being hoisted up in the air. We remember his breathing become more and more difficult. We remember him praying for his enemies. We remember him dying on the cross. We remember him being buried in a borrowed tomb. And Lord, we remember him getting up with all power and ascending back to heaven with you. So, Father, we remember and we are thankful and grateful. Jesus, we love you for your suffering and sacrifice for us. Thank you for dying. Thank you for reconciling. We give you glory. Now, since you died for us, Jesus, we're going to live for you, for your glory. It is in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus we pray and we ask it all. Amen. Well, let us commune together. Well, it said that after the Lord's Supper, they went to the Mount of Olives. We don't have a Mount of Olives, but we have our own homes we're going to go to. So if Deke, if you got another one in you, sir, if you got another good one that'll get us on the way out, we'd appreciate it. I know you got something in your spirit. We'll just follow you, sir.
Lord is getting us ready for that great day. Oh, God is getting us ready for that.
That's right.
Hallelujah, God is getting us ready for that. Oh, Lord, who shall be able? Oh, sinners will be running in that great day. Oh, sinners will be running in that. Hallelujah, sinners will be running in that.
Committee needs your help. Pastor's been talking about unity and stuff, so I know y'all seen that pitiful tree out there. We don't have any decorations, so what I want to do is to have everybody bring a decoration, one ornament, so we can decorate the tree. It's just to solidify that we're coming together and being unity. And so when you look at it, you'll say, oh, okay, I contribute to that. So that's kind of the thing that Pastor's trying to do now.
Yes.
So just bring it next Sunday, and we'll get it on there, and then you can look at what you've done. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Faye, and the decorating committee. Thank y'all. That is a wonderful idea. So please bring, you only have to be a member of this church. We're just unified. Just bring a decoration. Bring something to put on that tree and just put it on there so you can say, look, I'm a part of that. We're one tree, one church. That's it. One tree, one church. Amen. Thank y'all so much. Let me see. Yeah. Thank y'all for yesterday. Praise. If y'all want to see it, go to our YouTube page, Union Missionary Baptist Church, Muncie, on YouTube. Hit subscribe, and you'll be able to see the workshop from yesterday. And all our leaders, don't forget, mark your calendars for December the 18th. We are having our ad team meeting. And then for our youth, all of our youth, not limited to our union, but grades 5th through 12th, we're having a youth retreat, youth leadership retreat. That will be on Thursday, December the 30th. And what is the time? 10 to... Start sign in 9:30 and it'll start at 10 o'clock. We want to empower all of our youth. Look, the Lord is calling y'all, even in your young age, the Lord's calling y'all to be light in those places. And so our speakers will be Elder Long and Miss Deanna. They're actually back there, so wave your hands so they can see. I'm telling you, y'all gonna be in for a treat. So please spread the word. We want to fill this place with youth on December the 30th, and that's on a Thursday. So it's over Christmas break, so there's no excuse. And so we want you guys to come out and join us for that workshop. All right, thank y'all so much. Let me get ready to close us out. Senior Saints is Monday, second Monday of this month. Okay, so Senior Saints will meet the second Monday of this month at 11 o'clock in the Jackson Family Life Center. And so to all of our guests, thank you all. We love y'all. Thank y'all for visiting us. See some sprinkled in the back and all over. Thank y'all for visiting us. We appreciate y'all. Let me close with a word of prayer. Well, Father, we bless you and thank you again for your word. Thank you for this worship experience. It has been good. It's been refreshing. And Lord, we just love you for that. Lord, help us. Help us to keep Jesus in the forefront of our minds. And Lord, we just want to do your will. We want you to be pleased with us. So we bless you and thank you even now. Thank you for all of those who made decisions for you. Pray your protection and blessings over their lives and their encouragement even now. Those that made decisions from their seat, thank you, Father, and we bless you for them. Now, Father, as we leave from this place, but never from your presence, be with us and stand by us as you always have been. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide henceforth and forever. Shall we all say together, amen. Greet somebody before you leave. Please make sure we have another ministry that will be meeting right after. And so if you could greet others in the narthex, we'd appreciate it. Thank you all so much. Have a wonderful day. Be safe and be blessed.